हरि ओम तत्सत श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम ओम सदा शिव समारंभं व्यास शंकर मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तं वंदे गुरु परंपरां श्रुति स्मृति पुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पाद शंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्र भाष्य कृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ओम सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ओम शांति शांति शांतिः ओम शन्नो मित्र शंवरुणः शन्नो भवत्वर्यमा शन्न इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः शन्नो विष्णुरुरुक्रमः नमो ब्रह्मणे नमस्ते वायो त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि ऋतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि तन्मामवतु तद्वक्तारमवतु अवतु माम् अवतु वक्तारम् ओम शांति 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 ओम यश्चंदसाम ऋषभो विश्वरूपः छन्दोभ्योध्यमृता संबभूव समेन्द्रो मेधया स्पृणोतु अमृतस्य देवधारणो भूयासं शरीरं मे विचर्षणं जिह्वा मे मधुमत्तमा कर्णाभ्यां भूरिविश्रुवं ब्रह्मणः कोशोऽसि मेधया पिहितः श्रुतं मे गोपाय ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः अहं वृक्षस्य रेरिव कीर्तिः पृष्टं गिरेरिव ऊर्ध्वपवित्रो वाजिनीव स्वमृतमस्मि द्रविणगं सवर्चसम् सुमेधा अमृतोक्षितः इति त्रिशंकोर्वेदानुवचनम् अहं वृक्षस्य रेरिव कीर्तिः पृष्टं गिरेरिव ऊर्ध्वपवित्रो वाजिनीव स्वमृतमस्मि द्रविणगं सवर्चसम् सुमेधा अमृतोक्षितः इति त्रिशंकोर्वेदानुवचनम्
एकादशः अनुवाकः 11th सेक्शन वेदमनूच्य वेदमनूच्य वेदमनूच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति वेदमनूच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति वेदमनोच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति वेदमनोच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति
To take that word, that sentence, the three words, four words actually. Vedam, anuchya, Vedam anuchya, acharyaha, third word, antevasinam, fourth, anushasti, fifth, the five words. Vedam, anuchya, आचार्यः अन्तेवासिनम् अनुशास्ति वेदम् अनुच्य वेदमनुच्य वेदमनुच्य आचार्यः वेदमनुच्याचार्यः वेदमनुच्याचार्यः वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनम् वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनम् अनुशास्ति वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनम् अनुशास्ति वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति
ओन्लि वन् स्वरिता आल् उदात्त सरस् शास्ति श अनुदात्तः
वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति वेदमनुच्याचार्योऽन्ते वासिनमनुशास्ति सत्यं वद
सत्यं वद
धर्मं चर
धर्मं चर
सत्यं वद
सत्यं वद
धर्मं चर
धर्मं चर
स्वाध्यायान्माप्रमदः
स्वाध्यायान्माप्रमदः
स्वाध्यायान्माप्रमदः प्रमदः
स्वाध्यायान्माप्रमदः
आचार्याय
आचार्याय
प्रियं धनमाहृत्य
प्रियं धनमाहृत्य
प्रजातन्तुम् मा व्यवक्षेत्सीः
मा
व्यवक्षेत्सीः मा व्यवक्षेत्सीः
क्षेत्सीः
आचार्याय प्रियं धनमाहृत्य
आचार्याय
प्रियं धनमाहृत्य प्रजातन्तुम् Mavyavachetsihi Acharyaya Priyam Dhanamahritya Prajatantum Mavyavachetsihi
Acharyaya Priyam
Dhanamahritya Prajatantum Mavyavachetsihi Vedamanuchyacharyonte vasinamanushasti
Vedamanuchyacharyonte vasinamanushasti
Satyam vada
Satyam vada
Dharmanchara
Dharmanchara
Dharmanchara Swadhyaya Anma Pramadaha
Swadhyaya Anma Pramadaha
Acharyaya Priyam Dhanamahritya Prajatantum Mavyavachetsihi
Acharyaya Priyam
Dhanamahritya Prajatantum Mavyavachetsihi Acharyaya Priyam Dhanamahritya Prajatantum Mavyavachetsihi
Acharyaya
Priyam Dhanamahritya Prajatantum Mavyavachetsihi Satyanna Pramaditavyam
Satyanna Pramaditavyam
Satyanna Pramaditavyam
Satyanna Pramaditavyam
Dharmanna Pramaditavyam
Dharmanna
Pramaditavyam
Dharmanna Pramaditavyam
Kushalanna Pramaditavyam
Kushalanna Pramaditavyam
Kushalanna Pramaditavyam
Kushalanna Pramaditavyam
Bhutyena Pramaditavyam
Bhutyena Pramaditavyam
Bhutyena Pramaditavyam
Bhutyena Pramaditavyam
Swadhyaya Pravachanabhyam
Swadhyaya Pravachanabhyam
Swadhyaya Pravachanabhyam
Swadhyaya Pravachanabhyam
Swadhyaya Pravachanabhyam Na Pramaditavyam
Swadhyaya
Pravachanabhyam Na Pramaditavyam Deva Pitrukaryabhyam
Deva Pitrukaryabhyam
Na Pramaditavyam Na Pramaditavyam Deva Pitrukaryabhyam Na Pramaditavyam Deva Pitrukaryabhyam Na Pramaditavyam Deva Pitrukaryabhyam Na Pramaditavyam
Deva
Pitrukaryabhyam Na Pramaditavyam Matru Devo Bhava
Matru Devo Bhava
Matru Devo Bhava
Matru Devo Bhava
Pitru Devo Bhava
Pitru
Devo Bhava Acharya Devo Bhava
Acharya
Devo Bhava Atithi Devo Bhava Atithi Devo Bhava Matru Devo Bhava.
Matru Devo Bhava.
Pitru Devo Bhava.
Pitru Devo Bhava.
Acharya Devo Bhava.
Acharya Devo Bhava.
Atithi Devo Bhava.
Atithi Devo Bhava.
Let us continue. So this morning, very elaborately, we saw why the teacher again repeats the teachings of Dharma Shastram in a nutshell in this section. So here it is said the teacher addressed his students in his final valedictory function. There is also another contention. Maybe the teacher addressed this to his students after they finished their Veda Dhyanam, before they started their study of Dharma Mimamsa, before they started their analytical study. Anyway, whenever it was addressed, it's a very good teaching. When a student spends 8 to 12 years in a Gurukulam with a teacher, a resident student, Ante Vasi, he learns. And when he finishes his course of Veda Dhyanam, as I said this morning, he has an option of continuing to stay in a Gurukulam to pursue Brahma Vidya, or he can go back to his life. And for all the students, here teacher is addressing. In fact, those students who completed their Veda Dhyanam means they must have also understood the meanings of the words of the Shastram of the Karma Kanda portion. So the desire to know Dharma is called Dharma Jignyasa. What I should do, how I should do, how I should live my life hereafter. Dharma Jignyasa. That's why the first sutra, there the Jaimini Sutra, Sutrani has this sutra, Athato Dharma Jignyasa. Athato Dharma Jignyasa. Like how Athato Brahma Jignyasa is the first sutra of here, Brahma Sutra, Brahma Sutra. So the Veda Dhyanam, study of the Vedic chanting is complete only when he also understands the meanings of Dharma Shastra. He would not have understood, he need not have understood the meaning of Vedanta mantras also. But definitely he must have understood the meanings of the Karma Kanda portion, Dharma Shastram. Such a student, after having understood, completed his study, he is called Snataha. the person who has complete the time. Snataha means one who has completed his study. Therefore, now who is there now, not as a brahmachari. The person who is called Snataha is no more a brahmachari. In the sense, he is supposed to change his ashrama. Snataha. It's called Avabhritasnanam. Avabhritasnanam means after the completion of his Vedadhyayanam, the knowledge of the Dharma Shastram, the person is ready. It's called Avabhritasnanam. The person, the student, is called Snataha. This Snataha is the one who is no more a brahmachari. Because now he has left that ashrama. Which means now he cannot be hanging around simply without being a brahmachari. And there's a short period of time he can be a snataha. And he must become a grihastha. See, every individual must belong to any one of the ashramas. So that you have ordained duties to follow. Beautiful. You are a brahmachari, then there are brahmachari ashrama. There are duties to be followed by a student. Always study, study, study without distraction, focused attention. That is the duty of a brahmachari, a brahmachari ashrama. And that is complete. Now, Avabhritasnanam is over, which means has completed the study. The completion of the study implies this Avabhritasnanam. So, this person is Snataha. Therefore, now he has to enter into Grihastha Ashrama, next stage of life. No, I do not want to be, you know, I do not want to be a grihastha. Then you cannot call yourself brahmachari. Otherwise, you should continue to stay in the ashram for further pursuit of knowledge of the truth. Just continue your brahmachari, isn't it? Ashrama. Otherwise, you leave the brahmacharya ashrama after the study means snataha. It is his snataha and he has the responsibility of giving dakshina to his teacher. When he enters into the gurukulam, he is given complete free education, complete free teaching. Because in Vedic tradition, there is no such thing called fees. So he has complete accommodation was free, food was free, teaching was free, everything was free. The only duty was to be focused and study all that without any distraction. That is why the brahmacharis have supposed to have all brahma varchas. Because always thoughts are in the shastra. Like our Ishwar. There we go. Okay, just to wake you up. So yes, before, as a snataha, after leaving the brahmacharya ashrama, before entering into grihastha ashrama, and this student is supposed to visit a king, or some other rich person in the Vedic society who appreciates the teaching, the Vedic tradition, Vedic culture. Another fellow at the office, this person visits and he exhibits his talent in terms of what he has learned he shows his scholarship. And whoever is there, naturally very appreciative of this person's accomplishment. And they bless him with some, they gift him with money or some, whatever he deserves. And the student comes back with that and gives dakshina to his teacher. The desired dakshina he gives the teacher. Then he can enter into grihastashrama. And such a student, he is about to leave. Here the teacher addresses.
Vedamanuchyacharyonte vasina manushasti. Vedamanuchyacharyonte vasina manushasti.
So Vedam Anuchya. So Anuchya, after having taught, Anu means Uktva, having taught. Anuchya means the after, means first he teaches for some time, for many years, having this one as his resident student. So having taught Anuchya, Vedam Anuchya, having taught the Vedas, now Acharyaha, the teacher, Anushasti. Acharyaha, the teacher, Anushasti. Now, the word Vedam, Vedaha means the entire Veda. Karma Kanda, Upasana Kanda, Jnana Kanda, all the Upanishads, all their everything. Here, Vedam Anucha, as a Brahmachari, when he leaves the Gurukulam, as a snataha, how much does he know? He knows all the mantras. He is committed to the memory. And also, he has analyzed the meanings of the Dharma Shastra. But still, Vedanta is yet to analyze. Let us do it. And that student, the teacher, Anushasti, instructs. Anushasti, the word Shasti means governs. Literally, it means governs, rules. That's why the Shastram is said to be Shastram. The scripture in Sanskrit is called Shastram. Nowadays, the word Shastram, any discipline is called Shastram. Sangeeta Shastram, Ayurveda Shastram, Bhautikash, any discipline of art is always said to be Shastram. But actually, Veda is the Shastram. Why? Because Shasti Trayate Iti Shastram. Shasanat Trayate Iti Shastram. That which protects the students by governing their way of life. That's why Shastra itself is called Shastra. But here, Anushasti means rules. That's it. One of the meaning Shastra means rules. But here the teacher instructs. Why such a verb is used here? The teacher instructs the students that what he is instructing should be strictly followed. Unless he follows his instructions, what he's going to give now, and he had to face very unpleasant consequences. Because he will be missing. The whole Shastra study, the purpose of the study would not be possible. Therefore, he has to strictly follow. So, to remind the student of his commitment, to be persistent and serious in following his instructions, even the Upanishad person puts this verb anushasti, instructs. The teacher instructs after having taught. Vedam anuchya acharyaha anushasti. The very word acharyaha tells, even when somebody tells, the student need not listen. But acharyaha anushasti, an acharya instructs, his instructions are to be strictly followed for his own wellness, for his own well-being, for his own purification, for his own growth, for his own upliftment, for his own accomplishment of the best in his life. If an acharyaha, already I have told the meaning of good acharyaha. Acharyaha, so all the students come and study Veda. And later on, in keeping with the profession also, in keeping with those inclinations of the profession, and students will be taught different other shastras. So, Kshatriya will be taught along with Vedic knowledge. Kshatriya also should learn other disciplines of archery, he must gain knowledge in warfare, etc. So, Vaishya will be learning Arthashastra, economics, all those things. So different. So Brahmana will commit himself to the study of the Shastram and for the propagation of the Shastra. All those people should be studying the Shastram, Veda. But Brahmana is also assigned the duty of continuing to teach these scriptures also. So, this Acharyaha Achinoti Shastrani. He collects the teachings of all this, from all disciplines. Acharya Sthapayati. And he places his students in their right conduct. Swayam acharati yasmat. Tasmat acharya uchyate. And he himself lives his teaching. Therefore, he sets an example for his students. The teacher's life becomes a message for his student. Especially being around the teacher, living in the gurukulam, living near the teacher, the student learns more by observing the teacher also. That's why the very word acharyaha, teacher, not just the one who teaches English language, one who teaches is the teacher. Okay, the teacher is the one who teaches and also lives the teaching, setting an example as a role model. And this teacher, acharyaha, Veda Manucha Anushasti. And he instructs the student, the resident student who is about to leave. Ante Vasinam Anushasti. Even though it is the Ante Vasinam is in singular, and only one student he is addressing, but many students would have been listening to him. Ante Vasinam Anushasti. Because following his instructions will make his life a tapas. Even Yankada asked for meaning of the word tapas. Why Upanishad emphasizes tapas? See, the word tapas, I'll tell you again today. Firm commitment with a strong will. Firm commitment with a strong will to one's pursuit is tapas. There's also another meaning of the word tapas. Being given to the discipline of the pursuit of enquiry into the meaning of the words. Those are tapas. Suppose it's a tapas, it's a discipline. The person is strictly given to the pursuit of the knowledge of the words of the Shastra, enquiry into the meaning of the words. Also tapas. So here, generally, how tapas is understood, apart from what I explained as a tapas as a discipline in the previous class, in fact, being given to this discipline of enquiry into the meaning of the words, pursuing the meaning of the words of the Shastra, strictly living a dharma-governed life is tapas. That is tapas. Strictly living a dharma-based life, dharma-governed life, along dharma-governed life, but given to the pursuit of knowledge of the words is tapas. Because such a tapas is very important, that alone will give a person samskaraha. In this context, Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada mentions this word samskara. Why the teacher instructs here? Because the student has to have samskaraha. Samskaranam means refining. Because there must be refinement on the part of the student. And samskaraha does not happen overnight. It takes time. In fact, every day must be lived. Daily, day after day after day, every day one must live one's life consciously. And the life must be governed with dharma and with the commitment to the pursuit of enquiry into the meaning of the words. This is the tapas. Only samskara is possible. It takes daily life. In due course of time, gradually mind becomes refined. Therefore, the teacher gives here instructions. What does he say first?
Vedamanuchacharyonte vasinamanushasti. Vedamanuchacharyonte vasinamanushasti. Satyam vada. Satyam vada.
The simple language, vada, do speak, imperative verb. So may you speak the truth, literal translation. May you speak the truth, may your speech be of fruitfulness. So when we happen to speak, we need to speak only if there is necessity. And if necessity is there to speak, and what we speak must be the truth. It means it must be based on valid means of knowledge. Before saying anything, what I say must be thoroughly analyzed, understood, and must be the truth. It must be as it is. Because this truthfulness in speech represents the whole integration, the harmony. If the truth is not spoken, then there cannot be alignment with the thought and the speech. The truth is spoken, there is alignment with the thought and speech. If alignment with the thought and speech, then it is possible for your deed also to be in alignment with thought and speech. If there is no alignment in thought and speech, then there cannot be alignment between thought, word and speech, thought, word and deed. Then there is disintegration. And the person will be a person of disintegration, and he will be of split personality. His thought is different, word is different, deed is different, and there is no harmony. See, all the sense organs, all the organs of actions, all the physiological functions, the mind, intellect, all of them must be together in harmony. It's called total integration. So this affects. So the untruth affects this harmony, this integration, and result in stress, depression, strain. That's why even in Yoga Shastra, these four disciplines, after Yama Niyama, Asanam is practiced also for the training the organs of actions. Pranayama is for training the physiological functions. Pratyahara is for training the sense organs. And Dhyana is for training the mind and intellect. These four disciplines, then yoga shastra also, for training, for integration, integrity. Therefore, satyam, of course, untruth will also contribute for hurting himself. Then we will be definitely disturbing the order. whenever there is any action contributes for hurting, there'll be disturbance in the order. And here, this truth, that's why this truthfulness in speech represents the whole harmony. What? Satyam vada. Satyam vada. First, you all know that you should speak the truth. Therefore, what is my knowledge? My knowledge of dharma is how I know what is right, I know what is wrong. I know without being taught by anybody, I know very well, being born a human being, that speaking the truth is right and not speaking the truth is wrong. And this, how do you understand? Because I expect from everybody else that others should speak the truth to me. When I come to know the other person has not spoken the truth to me, has lied to me, and I do get hurt. It can't help. It results in hurt. Therefore, speaking, not speaking the truth, really will result in hurt, himsa. Therefore, I don't want to be hurt. I want others to speak the truth to me. And my expectation of how others should behave with me is based on my own knowledge. I know, based on what I expect from others in terms of behavior, I know what is right, what is wrong. They said, we can never say, I do not know, I should have spoken. We can never say, I do not know. We know. We know speaking the truth is right. We know not speaking the truth is wrong. How do we know? Based on what I expect from others in terms of behavior, I know what is it and what is wrong. Therefore, it is first teaching is what? Satyam vada. Next, dharmam chara. So chara, may you follow. May you follow dharmam. May you follow dharmaha. The word dharmaha is a big word. What is the word dharma? The follow dharma means what? First, we have to understand. Here, dharma means, first, may you do all the shrautam smartam karma. May you do all the shruti ordained, smriti ordained duties which have been taught as part of the dharma shastra. So, may you live your religious life. May you live your religious life, we have to interpret it for our understanding also. May you do the Shruti ordained, Veda ordained, Smriti ordained duties. Means may you live your religious life. May you live your religious life means what? May you be prayerful and worshipful. May be prayerful and worshipful. Never forget invoking the grace of Bhagavan. Never forget expressing your thanks to Bhagavan for all that you are blessed with. Because that is how you are in harmony with the Lord in the form of everything. So, dharmam chara. And then it is, may you do all your duties in all the roles you have to play. May you do all your duties, all your duties consciously, wholeheartedly, attentively, in conformity with the values. Dharmam chara. Another meaning is what? May you do all your, remember all your role plays. And may you do all your duties, all the roles you have to play consciously, attentively, wholeheartedly, with the proper attitude as an offering the Lord in conformity with values. That is tapas. I already told you. So, dharmam chara. Again, do anything that you need to do with the presence of mind in keeping the situation. Suppose you are walking and you see a small ant is going. Just because you are walking, rushing the positive, you happen to see and see that you move or go. So you don't kill it. It's all this presence of mind. So you do consciously, be conscious, therefore you can do what is to be done with the presence of mind in a given situation. Understand? This is a situation will tell you what's appropriate. This is dharmam chara. So, satyam vada,
satyam vada,
dharmam chara,
dharmam chara.
Swadhyaya anma pramadaha.
Swadhyaya anma pramadaha.
The most important teaching is given already. Satyam vada dharmam chara. Dharmam chara is a very loaded word, okay? Loaded expression. Now he says, even now you have completed your study, you are going to go back. Even if you enter into the grihastha ashrama, and even when you get very busy with the many responsibilities and duties, grihastha ashrama means very high responsible ashrama. Therefore, you cannot say you don't have any time and see somehow find time, allot time in your doing your activities to do your swadhyaya. So swadhyaya ma pramadaha, may you not swerve from your swadhyaya, your study of the scripture. See, what you have studied, you must continue to study. Okay, always must be repeating. See, swadhyaya means not stopping. You should never stop. What you have studied in full-time program must be continued even throughout your life. Study should never be stopped. Because the study of the scripture will repeatedly reminding you of how you should be living, what you have learned. So, being swadhyaya, study of the scriptures, actually will help you to be a subject matter of the Shastra. And being a subject matter of the Shastra is being with Bhagavan. Being with Bhagavan is what? And then living one's life in harmony with the order. And be conscious of Bhagavan. Therefore, even tapas itself, a life of tapas itself is possible, as I said, a life of tapas. So the inquiry into the knowledge of the inquiry into the words, understanding of the teaching, and living a dharma governed life is possible only if you are in constant touch with the study of the scriptures. Very important. Easy to forget. Therefore, never stop.
Swadhyaya anma pramadaha. Swadhyaya anma pramadaha.
So may not swerve from your study of the scripture. Even though I told you many times, swadhyayaha means study of continuous, being given to the discipline of repeatedly studying one's own recension of Veda, one's own branch of the Veda. But here you should also understand the study of the scripture.
Swadhyaya anma pramadaha. Swadhyaya anma pramadaha. Acharyaya, acharyaya, priyam dhanamahritya, priyam dhanamahritya, prajatantum mavyavachetsihi, prajatantum mavyavachetsihi.
The teacher himself tells, first he says, Acharyaya priyam dhanam ahritya. Now, having earned, having got the desired money, a desired dakshina, to give the teacher, first you do that before marriage as a snata, before becoming a grihasthashrami, you must finish paying your dakshina. Why? Once you get married, you will be completely roped into your household duties and responsibilities, then you cannot share. So before marriage, so then go out, show your scholarship and get money from the person concerned, a king or some rich person, and then pay, give your dakshina to the acharya. Why? The teacher is greedy? No. Because the teacher gives free, everything free to the students, and he has to have again funds for the next set of students who are going to come to the Gurukulam. He must be able to provide always. So the students always, the graduates of this Gurukulam have to pay dakshina, have to bring and give dakshina. That's why we don't call the fee. There's no demand, this much you have, there's no demand. Whatever is possible, the best the student can give, but still priyam dhanam, which also pleases the teacher. Oh, good, my student has gone out, has pleased some king or somebody, has really, the whoever gives also must be informed person who knows, can value the teaching, and that person has given generously means, yes, this student also has got the priyam dhanam, the money which pleases this teacher. So the talk makes teacher happy because it's good for him to help next set of students who are going to come to the Gurukula. Therefore, Acharyaya priyam dhanam ahritya. First is first duty. Then one cannot be hanging around without being a brahmachari. Now next one must take up, ready to take one's next duties of a next stage of life. One should get married. And Shankaracharya says beautifully, one should get married to a wife anurupan, dara anupan daran ahritya. Get married to a person who has compatibility and a similar disposition. Get married and have progeny so that you do not break the lineage of your family. The thread of progeny should not be broken. And for the greater purpose of perpetuation of dharma, and also for perpetuation of the lineage of the family, see that you also have progeny, for which must get married to also a girl who is similar disposition. So he says, Prajatantum ma vyavachetsihi. Prajatantuhu, tantuhu means thread. Praja, progeny. Prajatantuhu, a thread of progeny. Ma vyavachetsihi, may you not break. Ma vyavachetsihi, may you not break the thread of progeny, means may you not break the lineage of your family. Because the lineage of family must be continued. The family values can be preserved for future generation again. And also the progeny should be there for the perpetuation of dharma. Therefore, the teacher gives instructions. Suppose because of some reasons, suppose you cannot have children also, try all possible means. He says in Putra Kameshti, those days he advises that, like Shankaracharya writes, suppose you cannot have, in case some because of some problems, you cannot have progeny for perpetuation of the lineage, then at least do some Putra Kameshti Yaga or some special prayers for that and see somehow you have progeny. And we nowadays we have to say go to very efficient gynecologist and of course mind with the methods. Like that, this is, there's a big conference especially on this in a Vaidya Grama in Coimbatore. I think somewhere they had. Anyway, okay. So here the teacher says, Prajatantum ma vyavachetsihi, may you not break the lineage of your family. That implies so many things. Get married to a girl, have progeny, see that you have children, that is the thing. And before that, see that Guru Dakshina comes to me. Acharya, are you all with me? Acharyaya priyam dhanamahritya prajatantum ma vyavachetsihi.
Acharyaya
priyam dhanamahritya prajatantum ma vyavachetsihi. Again, only when the children are there, there'll be family. The family values. And here, even children should grow up in an atmosphere where they naturally cultivate, imbibe all the values, Shraddha in Shastram, even the worship, prayer, everything, just by seeing the parents, the children should learn also. Because the Shraddha in the Shastram cannot be cultivated logically. Why? Because Veda Shastram is not scientific. Veda is not scientific. Then still Veda is very unique and great because Vedic teaching does not contradict reasoning, and does not contradict science. That is the strength of the Veda. Veda is not scientific, but Veda does not contradict science. That is the strength of Veda, uniqueness of Veda. Therefore, because it cannot be logically proven, Veda is valid. It cannot be logically proven. Before even the child starts logic, develops logical thinking, when you're very young age onwards, very young, before even 7 or 6, the child must be really exposed. We brought up in an atmosphere where the children pick up, imbibe the values, Shraddha. This is also part of this teaching.
Acharyaya priyam dhanamahritya prajatantum mavyavachetsihi. Acharyaya priyam dhanamahritya prajatantum mavyavachetsihi.
So prajatantum mavyavachetsihi, may you not break the lineage of your family, means not only that, you also see your children also grow up in an atmosphere where they imbibe all the values you have learnt and picked up. But they also will become like you in future, so that the family lineage will continue. It will not be broken. Okay, next. Again, sometimes the teaching is emphasized. To reinforce the teaching, sometimes it is repeated in a different voice. It's a passive voice. Satyam vada, active voice. So,
satyanna pramaditovyam. Satyanna pramaditovyam. Dharmanna pramaditovyam. Dharmanna pramaditavyam.
No, satyat na pramaditavyam. Literally, what it means is satyat na pramaditavyam. So, literally, it means it should not be swerved. Literally, it means it should not be swerved from following the discipline in terms of speech. One should not swerve from speaking the truth. The discipline of truthfulness in speech. Satyatna pramaditavyam. One should not swerve. You should not. May you not swerve from discipline of truthfulness in speech. All you have seen that. Satyam vada, all it was said in active voice. Now it is said in passive voice. It should not be swerved by you from speaking the truth. You should not swerve. Means may not be indifferent. May not be indifferent to this discipline of speaking the truth. Which means when we say something, we should do things in such a way that our words come true. Even for fun, when we say something, and we should see that it happens. Even for fun, we should avoid telling lies. Some used to mean, sometimes the father has to go out the child will want to go with, wants to go with the father. And he wants to avoid, but he cannot take the child where he goes. He should not take also. The child will not leave. Mother has to tell a lie. I'm not going to the doctor. Injection. The child is okay. Stay back. The small, small things. Even you should avoid even such things. Suppose I tell you, okay, I'll get you chocolate. And then like the father thinks, so I told the child that you get the chocolate, but it goes through to affect the teeth, so I should not get him. So we what very careful in what you're saying and see that you do things that your words come true. How conscious we must be to be like that. That's why living a life of values means living and living on one's life with alertness, being very conscious of what I'm speaking. That's why what we speak must be the truth. If we have to speak, then we should speak the truth. If we don't need to speak, we can remain quiet. Chatu says. And that what I speak also should not be hurtful, should be pleasing. My word must be the truth and it must be pleasant word, pleasing word. Priyam. And just for the sake of pleasing also, it should not be a lie. And it must be relevant. Only then satya. Okay? What I speak must be spoken only if there's necessity. And if even because necessity if I have to speak also must be the truth. It should not be a lie. And it should be pleasing. Pleasant. Expression, it must be a pleasing word, again it must be relevant also. So irrelevant, unnecessary, untruthful words must be avoided in our speech. Then our speech will be what? Will be this truth, discipline of truthfulness. Word may not be indifferent. Pramadaha mastu. Pramadaha means indifference. Let there not be indifference on your part regarding this discipline of truthfulness in speech. So may not swerve from speaking the truth.
Dharmana pramaditavyam. Dharmanna pramaditavyam, kushalanna pramaditavyam, kushalanna pramaditavyam.
Very important word. Kushalam means one's own wellness. Generally, kushalam means wellness. So here, kushalaka na pramaditavya, may you not be indifferent towards your own well-being. Means, whatever, see now we understand it is very important to live a life of values. It is very important to do things for the wellness of others also. So I must contribute for the social welfare, social wellness. Must involve myself in social service activities. Perfect. But Shastra says, nothing should be done at the cost of one's own wellness. There should not be self-negligence. You should not neglect, one should not neglect one's own physical health and mental wellness, emotional well-being. Then your service society has no meaning. Because even service to society, service to others, following values, everything is for your emotional maturity. It's everything for your spiritual growth, for your mental purity, for your own purification of mind, your own steadiness of mind, your own expansion of mind, your own preparedness for knowledge of the truth. You are doing even service. Why do I serve society? When service to society, my living a life of dharma, everything is ultimately to prepare my mind for knowledge. And I do service, I serve others, and then I neglect myself, my own well-being. What happens? Again, the purpose does not serve. Therefore, kushalat na pramaditavyam. May not swerve from taking care of your own wellness, your well-being. Self-negligence really will result in very great failure. Kushalat na pramaditavyam. Kushalat na pramaditavyam. Kushalanna pramaditavyam.
Kushalanna pramaditavyam.
Bhutyaina pramaditavyam.
Bhutyaina pramaditavyam.
Bhutyaina pramaditavyam.
Bhutyaina pramaditavyam.
See, bhutihi literally means wealth, glory. So, yet bhutye na pramaditavyam. One should not swerve from even acquiring wealth. Suppose one must do something, one must use one's own expertise or skill, whatever capacity, capability, skill one is blessed with, whatever knowledge one has, using that one must definitely earn wealth, make money in life, but in conformity with dharma. Shastra does not say don't earn wealth, don't touch money. No. Shastra does say bhutyaina pramaditavyam. One must acquire wealth through righteous means. Suppose the person is inclined for specific, inclined for learning or doing specific things, and the person should go by one's inclination, and one must learn, and one must become proficient in that. The person is capable of singing, capable of painting, capable of dancing, capable of doing anything else. Any given field, any different field, any field a person is inclined for, or interested in, or capable of doing, and the person should involve oneself in that. And see that one person gains proficiency in that, thereby one can also make money through righteous means. So this, because any skill, any proficiency, any efficiency, any capability, any inclination, any interest, it's all you earned it as a result of punya. You call it probably samskaras. Therefore, in keeping with one's inclination, interest, and capacity and taste, and one must develop one's skills, thereby one can acquire wealth. Why? What is wealth for? Bhutena pramaditavyam. It should not be swerved by you from acquiring wealth. Krishna's may not swerve, not be indifferent towards that. Towards earning wealth, be conscious, earn wealth, acquire wealth through righteous means. By using anything that you are blessed with, whatever you are blessed with. Why? Because what is money for? Dhanam dana. Money is for sharing, not only for one's own entertainment of enjoyment of pleasures. Wealth is not earned only for the enjoyment of one's own pleasures and one's own entertainment. Money should be earned through righteous means, also for sharing. And giving money to others, sharing wealth is means for the welfare of others, all for protection of dharma. And protection of dharma is for antakarna shuddhi. And antakarna shuddhi is for knowledge. And the knowledge is for my own freedom. That's why Vedic culture, whether you learn dance, you sing, you do paint, you do anything, everything is ultimately focused on what? Moksha jnana. That's why for us, dance is a discipline, Bhagavan is involved. Music is for us is a discipline, Bhagavan is involved. Art is for us a discipline, Bhagavan is involved. Any discipline of knowledge is ultimately to prepare yourself for discovering the swarupam of that discipline. The ultimate truth of every discipline is what? Bhagavan. The truth only. Isn't it? Therefore,
Bhotyena Pramaditavyam. Bhotyena Pramaditavyam.
So, all of the extracurricular activities a person is capable of, all round good, one must make adequate efforts in keeping the dharma. Always that should be as important to develop one's all round good.
Bhotena pramaditavyam. Bhotena pramaditavyam. Swadhyaya pravachanabhyam na pramaditavyam. Swadhyaya pravachanabhyam na pramaditavyam. Swadhyaya pravachanabhyam na pramaditavyam.
Swadhyaya pravachanabhyam na pramaditavyam.
We all feel repetitive. Upanishad repeats. Already Shankara Bhagavatpada has given the reason, because the context is different. Before he was teaching, now the instruction is given before the student leaves. Therefore he remains.
Swadhyaya anma pramadaha.
I said already. Now he says again. Swadhyaya pravachanabhyam na pramaditavyam. Again, may you not swerve from your study of the scriptures. Always you must be constantly in touch with the subject matter of the teaching. And not only that, not only you study, you also. Another way of remaining in contact with the teaching is what? You share. Therefore, may you not swerve from your study of the scriptures and sharing your knowledge of scriptures with others.
Swadhyaya pravachanabhyam na pramaditavyam. Swadhyaya pravachanabhyam na pramaditavyam. Deva Pitru Karyabhyam na pramaditavyam. Deva Pitru Karyabhyam na pramaditavyam.
Even before, already we have seen why Swadhyayaha, because the clarity always enhances, so the study must be continuous, and by sharing is also for preserving the teaching. Only when you share your knowledge with others, others who learn from you will be, they will learn, they can again teach others. So that for preserving the teaching, for perpetuation of teaching also, the lineage of teachers also, one must teach. We must teach.
Deva Pitru Karyabhyam na pramaditavyam. Deva Pitru Karyabhyam na pramaditavyam. Deva Pitru Karyabhyam na pramaditavyam.
Deva Pitru Karyabhyam na
pramaditavyam.
So, may you not swerve, may you not deviate from your Deva Yajnaha and Pitru Yajnaha. Deva Karyam, Deva Yajna. Pitru Karyam, Pitru Yajna. May not swerve, deviate from your duties in terms of Deva Yajna and Pitru Yajna. So, worship of Devatas, worship of Bhagavan and of Devatas, offering oblations to Devatas, so performing a Nitya Puja, Nitya Karma, regularly, the rituals to be performed regularly should not be stopped. So Deva Yajna, worship of Devata is very important. But only by worshipping Bhagavan in the form of Devatas, by invoking the grace of Devatas, there's propitiation on your part. So the Devatas propitiated will bless you with all that you need in life. So, in fact, worship is another means of invoking the grace of Devatas for prosperity. Worship is really worship properly done, should bless you with prosperity. Worship is a will involved action, it will never fail. It never fails. If Shraddha, if any worship is done properly with the great Shraddha, seriously, fervently, definitely it will bless the worshipper with the prosperity. So we need the grace of Devatas, the one of Devatas, for all our accomplishments. For our food, for our shelter, for our clothing. As I said already, we are the mercy of the Devatas. Therefore, Shastram says, again, it's a discipline. That is how, again, offering oblations to Devatas or worshipping the Devatas makes you live in harmony with the total universe also. And therefore, may you not deviate from your duty of worshipping the Devatas, Nitya Karma. Similarly, Pitru Yajnaha. Also, may not deviate from your duty of expressing your reverence for your parents, worshipping your ancestors. Suppose if the ancestors have, there are certain called Naimittikam Karma, the rituals to be done occasionally, Naimittikam Karma, and the ancestors, when the elders die, suppose the people, the sons, they must worship. There is the Masikam Masiki Titi, every month on a given Titi, they worship ancestors for a year. And thereafter, every year on Varshiki Titi, they worship on the same Titi, same date. This, and as for the Vedic calendar date, they worship the ancestors. And then they also give dhanams in their names, they share. It's all Pitru Karma. And not only that, suppose your parents, suppose they do tarpanam, means something, tarpanam means satisfying. It's a ritual by doing which they satisfy their ancestors. Then they satisfy them. Suppose the ancestors have taken a new body and they're already born. Still, it will reach them. Okay? Whatever ritual you do, the effect of the ritual, definitely, it will reach them. Suppose if they have attained Videha Mukti, they are not born anymore. They have attained Jnanam, attained Videha Mukti, they are not there. Still, what the karma you do, the ritual you do, the worship you perform, your worship of ancestors will bless, at least it will reach other people in the family who did not have children. What Shastra says. Suppose, no, I don't believe all these things. If you do not believe in all these things also, doesn't matter. Still, you must you must follow a duty of ancestral worship. May not deviate from this discipline of worshipping ancestors. See, everything you do is converted into a discipline, preparatory discipline. Do it with a Shraddha. Do it with reverence. Okay. Deva Pitru Karya Bhyam Na Pramaditavyam.
Deva Pitru Karya Bhyam Na Pramaditavyam.
Deva Pitru Karya Bhyam Na Pramaditavyam.
Deva Pitru Karya
Bhyam Na Pramaditavyam.
So may not deviate from worship of devatas and ancestors. Now, here Upanishad, having taught the Panchamahayagnas in a nutshell, and also the values, now Upanishad wants to teach us what sort of attitude we should have. And his attitude towards our own parents first. What should be my attitude towards my parents? The teaching on values, teaching on the forms of worship, Panchamahayagnas, is over with this. It's going to come again later on. But timing is over. And now the teaching, this attitude begins here.
Matru Devo Bhava. Matru Devo Bhava.
Why attitude? Why the Shastram teaches to have a proper attitude. Proper attitude. See, when you have an attitude, that attitude needs to be expressed. That attitude needs physicalization. The attitude should manifest in action. Once my attitude manifests in action, then that action will strengthen the attitude. Attitude expressed in action becomes strengthened by the action. Therefore, Upanishad tells here,
Matru Devo Bhava, Matru Devo Bhava.
Bhava means may you become, may you be. What should you be? May you be the one for whom Mother is the Lord. May you be the one for whom Mother is the Lord. Mother is Bhagavan. Means may you see your Mother as Bhagavan. Mother as Devata, Mother as God. May you invoke God in the form of your Mother. Even if Mother has some, as a human being, Mother is also a human being. She is also an individual being. She may have her own defects, her own limitations, her own problems. Because nobody in the world is perfect. No human being is perfect. Only Bhagavan is called Purushottamaha. Only flawless person, only flawless being is Bhagavan. We all have our own limitations and defects and problems. So Mother also, we have problems, limitations. And sometimes even you may not be able to agree with her views and opinions also. Sometimes the Mother's guidance might result in failure for you, would not have worked for you. Still, there shall be any indifference on your part in having reverence towards her. There will be great respect and reverence for Mother, because Mother is the one person who cannot be replaced by anything in the world. Nothing in the world can replace Mother. The one person who definitely wants a child to be happy and peaceful. Always a well-meaning person. And not only that, it is the Mother. See, Atma does not touch, cannot touch anything. Assuming the body, the first touch, first contact happens with the Mother's womb. First contact with the world is what? The Mother's womb. Only the Mother. Poor Mother definitely deserves all reverence and respect. Definitely Mother also most well-meaning person in the world for a child. Therefore, may always invoke Bhagavan in him of your Mother. Always see your Mother as Bhagavan. Will be the one for whom Mother becomes Bhagavan, the Lord.
Matru Devo Bhava, Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava.
Same way the Father. One must have respect and reverence for Mother, Father. Even if there are lots of complaints that I have about my father, so sometimes we have our own way of finding fault with, especially parents also. I have not really enjoyed the love and affection what I deserve. Not brought me up well, has not done what I wanted to do. May not help me to study what I want to study. A lot of problems we may have with the father also, because we will definitely find fault with the father with all his limitations. Sometimes the father might have failed because of situations and circumstances in doing what he was supposed to do also. Even then, the father would not have been like that, even then. And Father, definitely always there must have been an interest in raising one son and daughter well. A sincere effort must have been there on the part of the person. The situations and surroundings might not have supported. Therefore, always father deserves great reverence and respect. Don't see the father as an ordinary person. See the father also as Bhagavan. May be the one for whom father is also Bhagavan. Invoke Bhagavan in the name of your father.
Pitrudevo bhava, Pitrudevo bhava.
See, however they were, only when you have such great reverence and respect for parents, mother and father as Bhagavan. Mother for me is Bhagavan. Really speaking, everything is Bhagavan, all are Bhagavan, mother is Bhagavan, father is Bhagavan. That will be only, that understanding will be there in the wake of the knowledge of the truth. But now you see father and mother as Bhagavan. Father as Bhagavan, mother as Bhagavan. Because definitely you invoke tremendous amount of blessings which will be good for your parents.
Matrudevo bhava, Matrudevo bhava, Pitrudevo bhava, Pitrudevo bhava. Acharya Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava.
See, suppose when you, even you know, some acquaintances, some friends who are known to you, some strangers who are known to you, suppose if they tell you best of luck or wish you all the best, you feel so happy. Somebody simply utters a word, wish you all the best, you feel pleased. Imagine your parents tell you, the bottom of the heart, wish you all the best. And I always, mother and father, pray to Bhagavan for your wellness and welfare. No doubt. And such parents definitely deserve great reverence. And next,
Acharya Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava.
And may you be the one for whom Acharya, the teacher, is God. May you invoke the Lord in the name of your teacher. May you see a teacher as Bhagavan, the Lord. Why? Because the teacher is what he is. Already you have seen the meaning of the word Acharya. The teacher, see, the mother contributes for the closeness with the mother in the very early years. The closeness with the father really blesses a child with emotional strength, makes a child emotionally healthy. The healthy attitude, the healthy mind, the healthy body, it's all because of mother's, father's care when you are very young. The close vicinity, the close, you know, living closely with parents, we do develop this healthy attitude and healthy mind and healthy body. So mother contributes for your physical growth and physical wellness. And the love and affection really contribute for a certain degree of emotional wellness also. And as a healthy minded child, when you go to the teacher, and teacher there or afterwards, where the parents cannot help you emotionally, there the teacher comes in the picture. To a certain degree, mother and father can help you, can educate you, can give you academic education, can feed you, look after you, can help you for your growth, can give you infrastructure, everything. But the teacher, where parents cannot help, there the guru comes. For further emotional growth, the teacher is the one who teaches the value of values. By teaching a object matter of the scripture, teacher teaches the value of values and emphasizes, makes you live values, and the teacher is the one who shows you, through teaching the subject matter shastra, the teacher shows you the goal of life and later on helps you understand that very, attain the goal in terms of blessing you with the knowledge of the truth, but giving you the vision of the shastra. The teacher is the one who contributes for the absolute maturity, helps you accomplish absolute maturity in terms of having the vision of the shastra. So having the vision of the shastra means having the vision of the truth, which is the subject matter of the shastra. Having the vision of the truth means having the vision of one's own self. And vision of the truth as one's own, as vision of one's own self, what is the vision of the shastram? One can have only when the subject matter of the shastram, the words of the shastram are unfolded by the teacher. So not only does the teacher give you the Brahma Vidya, the pramanam. Pramanam will be meaningless to the shastra. The teacher does not unfold the words of the shastra. You can appreciate the shastram being the pramanam only when it's unfolded by the teacher. And the teacher teaches the dharma and helps to live a dharma, makes you understand the value of dharma, thereby helps you understand the purushartha and helps you have all the qualifications, helps you attain knowledge. Thereby the teacher in fact fulfills the rest where parents stop. As a guru, the teacher is also called a guru, because one who removes the darkness of ignorance is guru. Only when the ignorance of the truth is resolved, the absolute maturity is found only in the wake of the knowledge of the truth. Knowledge is maturity in its complete sense. Brahmano Brahma Vedana. The verse says to the most mature is the Brahmana who has blessed with the vision of the truth. So whoever has the vision of the truth, any jnani is a Brahmana. Therefore, it is the teacher and who really takes care of your absolute wellness. This way, the teacher is the shastram, in fact. The shastram comes from the mouth of the teacher only becomes clear. When the teacher is guru, or is this Bhagavan, when you see the teacher as Bhagavan, maybe the one for whom the teacher is Bhagavan. It is the attitude we should have towards my teacher. What should be my attitude towards my teacher? I see him as the Lord. I see her as the Lord. I see my mother as the Bhagavan. I see my father as the Bhagavan. This is my attitude. Therefore,
Acharya Devo Bhava. Acharya Devo Bhava. Atithi Devo Bhava, Atithi Devo Bhava.
Because mantras are very simple, I just continue without giving you time for asking questions. I can stop in any time. So, Atithi Devo, I'll stop here in the next class. Atithi Devo Bhava. Again, already I said, Atithi is a guest who arrives without informing the date of day of your arrival. Another meaning is also there. Because those days, even a stranger who keeps traveling from village to village, or any of the pilgrims who go to different, who are on a pilgrimage, suddenly can come and knock at the door And they don't need to be a known relatives or friends. Any stranger can come. Even such a stranger who is on pilgrimage, who is on his way somewhere, will not stay next night. Therefore, the one for whom there is no second day, okay, under me, the one who will not stay another day. Titihi, dvitiya titihi, yasya na. Therefore, is atitihi. So he comes, and suddenly you don't need to ask who are you, where are you coming from, I can trust you or not. No question. Somebody comes, and definitely they can also understand. In those days in Indian houses, that such facilities were there. Without disturbing the family privacy, also they can be there. They can be given some food, and they can be there, and they can go next day. But they feel welcome, they feel they're well looked after, revered. Somebody comes, and may you see that the guest also as Bhagavan. Bhagavan has come, because the person would not have thought of only coming to your particular house. He was on his way, but he got dark, something happened, so he had to stop, which is the door, which is his house, just walks in. So that, the person, the host also sees, why this person stopped in front of my house? Is Bhagavan ordained? The guest also thinks, why I stopped here? Is Bhagavan ordained? Therefore, this Bhagavan ordained situation that he happened to come to this house. And such a guest, how do you see? See him as Bhagavan. Make him feel welcome. Make him feel comfortable. Share whatever you have, the food, the shelter, let him enjoy. And he will go next day. The host will not get worked up because definitely the host knows that he is on the image, he or she, the person will go next day. Atithi Devo Bhava. But it's not relevant for these days. People come with some. Now that's why the people, now you know why people don't get this carry bottles, water bottles on our tracks. You know the reason, I don't want to explain all those things. So people can bring anything anywhere. So many, that's why so many, this all checked. It's going through security in my car. You have a plane, you have that, you have this, so many that check. Because anybody can come, any anti-social element can come. Of thousands of passengers, these are passengers traveling. One person may do some harm. To escape, take care of one person, every passenger everybody has to go through all security check, all that, have to show everything open, and then they check here, check you, top to bottom. This is the situation today. So it is not practical to trust people to have accommodate such people. Suddenly somebody comes and knocks at the door. There's no need also. Nowadays hotels and things are there. All they can communication is possible. Whole jagat now, emails and the WhatsApp and then Instagram, whatever they have, all facilities are there, highly developed technologically. This is not necessary. But anyway, the attitude, how should you have towards your guests?
Atithi Devo Bhava. Atithi Devo Bhava.
So we'll start next class. It was very light. Simple and nice. Any questions?
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Tat Sat Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.
Too many questions?
No questions. Swamiji, could you please repeat once more the order of the teaching here, starting from just that the order, not just of today, but the whole picture.
Yeah, I'll be summarizing anyway at the end of this chapter. Once I complete all 11 chapters, I'll be summarizing. Okay, just tell you again now. See, there are 11 alavakas, 11 sections. The first section consists of the Shanti Mantra, peace invocation, for elimination of the obstacles arising from three different sources. And the second section presents the science of phonetics, the rules to be followed in pronouncing the letters. Then we saw that Varnaha, Swaraha, Matra, Balam, Sama, Santa. Remember, these six factors should be taken care of in our. These six factors associated with the language should be taken care of in our chanting. Okay. And the third section presented an upasana. Samhitopasana. A meditation. And I said the meditations presented in this first chapter are studied only with an academic interest, not for practice, because they're meant for students who are exposed to the proper Vedic study. But we have substitutes. What meditation we are practicing now? A substitute for those. So Samhita means the combination of letters. Euphonic combination of letters. How the letters are in their close proximity. This is called a combination of letters. Usually, when two words come together in forming a compound or sometimes, otherwise also, always the final letter of the preceding word and the following letter of the first letter of the following word, they combine. Some chain takes place. But here, we take those factors associated with this combination of letters as the symbols in this meditation. The preceding form, Purva Rupam, is taken as one Alamban symbol. And the following letter, the first letter of the following word, Uttara Rupam, is taken as another symbol. Then there is definitely these two letters come together. There is a meeting point between the two letters. Meeting point, we understand. They do meet. And that is taken to be Sandhi. That itself is taken as one symbol. then when two letters come together, because of the combination rules, another letter sometimes gets inserted. Other letter emerges there. That newly emerging letter is also taken to be another alambanam. It is called sandhanam. The four factors associated with this combination of letters, purva rupam, uttara rupam, sandhihi, sandhanam. These four are taken to be alambanam. And on these four, the symbols, but actual objects of meditation are different objects. And we have five set of four devatas, four objects of meditation. We saw them. It's Vyakriti Upasanam, sorry, Sanvita Upasanam, but we saw there Adhiloka Samhitopasanam, Adi Jyotisha Samhitopasanam. Like that, we saw five meditations and the same four factors associated with the combination of letters known as Purva Rupam, Uttara Rupam, Sandhihi, Sandhanam. The four were taken as symbols for these five groups of objects. So you have five meditations, but all the five are taken to be one meditation. Understand? That was prescribed. Then if it is practiced with the desire for specific result of meditation, it's called Sakama Upasanam, then definitely one will enjoy the specific result which is properly practiced. Suppose without, I'm not really interested in the result. I'm practicing this meditation only for my mental stillness, for knowledge. Yeah? If a person practices such an attitude, then this becomes a nishkama upasana. Definitely, it will contribute for mental purification, mental stillness. That is the result of meditation. So, Samhita upasana is discussed in the third anuvagaha. Clear? Again, now the fourth anuvaka is a very special anuvaka where Upanishad presents the mantras consisting of prayer for specifically medha shakti, sharp intellect, good power of intellection, and also another mantra consisting of prayer for wealth. And this mantra consisting of prayer for medha is for japaha, regular chanting, recitation. And this prayer for mantra consisting of prayer for wealth involves also a performance of homaha. This way swaha, the word is coming. The fourth anuvaka. Then fifth anuvaka presents Vyakriti Upasana. And we saw the four Vyakritis. I explained to you what those Vyakritis were now. Bhuhu, Bhuvaha, Suvaha, these three special Vyakritis revealed to Brahma. And one Mahaha is another Vyakriti which is revealed to the Rishi Mahachamasyaha. These four are taken as alambanas, mean symbols. Again, there are objects, there are only four upasanas here, probably 16 objects like Adiloka, Vyakriti Upasanam, like that we have again 16 objects meditated upon these four Vyakritis. It's called Vyakriti Upasanam. And this Vyakriti Upasanam should not be practiced independently, it must be combined with the meditation upon Hiranyagarbha. Antar Hridaya Hiranyagarbha Upasana. Which is discussed in the next Anuvakaha. Hiranyagarbha Upasana is discussed in the next sixth anuvagaha. And the seventh, now how many passes are over? Samhita, Vyahruti, Hiranyagarbha. And the next, another upasana, is also Hiranyagarbha upasana. Antarhrudaya, no, Pantha Brahma upasana. Pantha Brahma upasana or Pantha Hiranyagarbha upasana was discussed afterwards. It's the fourth meditation. Fourth meditation is seventh chapter, seventh section. Pantha Brahmopasanam, Pantha Hridaya, Pantha Hiranyagarbhopasanam. So there I explained to you, Pantham means five. Pantham means a group of five members, five factors. So how the whole is also divided into three groups of five factors. The individual also is divided into three groups of five factors, and these individual three groups of five members are the symbols, means symbol, not symbol, which invoke the three groups of five members of the whole upon these three groups of five members of the individual. It is called Pantha Brahma Upasanam. Fourth meditation discusses the seventh anuvaka. Then eighth anuvakaha, we had the fifth meditation called Omkara Upasana. Even though that there is one sentence, Om iti Brahma, Om iti idagum sarvam, that's all finished. May you make it upon Omkaraha as Hiranyagarbha. This is the instruction. Nothing much about meditation. There's no discussion at all on the meaning of Omkaraha, isn't it? There's no meditation as such. There's nothing much about discussion. No, nothing is there about meditation also, except this one sentence. We meditate upon Omkara Hiranyagarbha. But still, Upanishad, the commentators write this section as meditation upon Omkaraha. But the whole section presents the glory of Omkaraha. How glorious Omkaraha is. So we saw how all these people of all different Vedas, Hotru Ganaha, Advaryu Ganaha, Udgatru Ganaha, Agnidhra Ganaha, all these Vedikas, all of them in their discussion, even to as an expression of permission or acceptance or approval or command or everything, they use Omkaraha. Om is the word which enjoys prominence, because Om is what it is. The glory of Omkara. Why Upanishad presents the glory of Omkara? So that if you know how glorious Omkara is, you will be inspired to meditate upon Omkara. That's the idea. This is presented in the 8th anuvaka. Now Manuvaka, 9th Anuvaka, discusses again the values, attitudes. And 10th Anuvaka presented Rishi Trishanku's declaration of his vision of the truth. 11th anuvaka now we are seeing. It repeats. I said, what Dharma Shastra is. Dharma Mimamsa means analytical study of the mantras of Karma Kanda. It's called a Dharma Mimamsa, Dharma Shastra. And there, what is there? The subject matter is presented. The three important factors are discussed. Mainly all about rituals. Elaborate discussion on the prominent, important the rituals, the numerous rituals, main subject matter. Then the attitude that we should have towards everything in life. The second, and the third one is ethics. third top. So this is, but there, the voluminous 12 chapters, so much is discussed, and there's so much is condensed and given in a nutshell in this 11th section. Are we satisfied here?
Thank you very much. Yes.